Thank you, Enrico, for this introduction and for the invitation. Good morning to all. So I'm going to talk about valorization of research results. And in order to do so, I would like to start with considering which assets the university have for research valorization. Well, probably the first assets we have at the university is, well, actually the skills we can find amongst our staff, our people. So we got many resources, tangible, very practical and intangible, and the first ones are about the skills. Then we got financial means, so money basically, to provide research. And then of course we have more tangible resources, like equipment, buildings, etc. Some of these resources are very practical and tangible. I don't know how we should consider digital resources, probably as intangible, but very practical as well at the same time. And then we have a set of data, knowledge, know-how. I mean, the more formalized we go, the closest we go to industrial property. If you think about it, we could consider that from data and knowledge, you build know-how, and if you formalize it enough, if it's new and inventive, of course, you can get a patent at the end of the day. But we don't have only scientific and technical skills. We also have specific skills dedicated to knowledge and technology transfer, and that includes, of course, skilled people and methods, policies, and procedures about knowledge transfer. So in a nutshell, we got people, we got money and material resources, and then we got knowledge and intellectual property. So that includes the intangible assets I mentioned before, so IP rights, know-how, etc. Some of very important intangible assets deal with reputation and image. And that can lead us again to intellectual property, because we, in certain cases, we can use our names, logos, brands. So that brings us to trademarks. I would say, to conclude on this resources part, that the most important resource is actually about people. And so the teams involved in research valorization, teams are extremely important. What would be the perfect team for proof of concept or technology transfer or knowledge transfer project? I would say this team should include, of course, scientific and technological staff, okay? But also people specialized in tech transfer and knowledge transfer, so that they are usually working in TTOs. And we can also add in that business developers, IP specialist, and they could be internal. I mean, they could be internal staff within the TTO, generally speaking, or they could be also external resources. And that could bring us to the question of how we can work with PatLib. Now, let's have a look at the special position that IP has got within the university. Well, IP, as seen, is only one part of the different assets that we have. And I'm perfectly aware I've been invited by a patent office, but I have to say that patent is only one of the tools, all right? One part of IP. I know that patent could be are sometimes very important, but I like to speak about that. So why do we need intellectual property and patents? Well, we can use them for collaboration, research collaboration with our industrial partners. We can use it, of course, for knowledge and technology transfer, and we can use it, and we need to use it most of the time when we try to create spin-off. Now, what's really needed about IP? I would say that we definitely need better information, and we need also to foster an intellectual property culture amongst the different stakeholders. We also need to demonstrate the good practice, and I would say also that we have to definitely get into the way to the best use of IP. And sometimes I got the feeling that within the TTOs and within the university, we don't really use the best use, probably because we don't see all the time what the best use could be or would be. And that is obvious, especially with the small size and medium size partners, let's say SMEs. Now, for whom do we need this spreading of information and culture? Well, that's definitely for our people, I would say academic people, and it is not only researchers or PhD students. This is also for administration within the university, and this is also for the leadership. So it's very important that, for instance, our vice rector for research or president of universities are involved in this process. And that means that at minimum, they should be aware. So we can provide information and culture about IP from inside, from the TTO. But I would say that external stakeholders are sometimes better heard from inside. And there again, I think about PathLib. As I said, you must be two to negotiate at least. And so that means also that the ideal situation would be that our industrial partners have got the same level of information and culture about intellectual property, about patents. And there again, this is particularly true for small and medium-sized enterprise, because most of the time they don't have really the skills for that. They don't have the staff, they don't have the time also to really get trained on these issues. And I think this is very important in order to avoid misunderstandings and situation where you might actually expect what the other partner might not be in position to give, especially about IP and IP rights. Now, what role could we imagine for PathLib in this situation? I would say that the situation, as far as I know, so I might be not well informed about this subject, but I should be. So I would say, though, that PathLib are not always very well known. So because also the offer is quite diverse, it might change for a country to another one. I mean, it might be very different according to the different regions and organizations. So the offer is not very clear for the TTOs and for the other stakeholders. So we can definitely work on that together. I think that the first real support from PathLib could be about information about existing IP, so what's called the BIP, the background IP. And why do we need background IP? Well, the good practice would be that before launching a new research project, you just go around the landscape and check what's already existing and happening. And patents is obviously a very rich source of information about that. Of course, background IP is extremely important for our freedom to operate. And that includes getting into research partnership for the academic side, and obviously getting in freedom to operate on the commercial side for our industrial and commercial partners. Obviously, creating new IP depends on the existing landscape. So there again, before getting into new IP, new patents, the study of anteriorities is extremely important. So this is why we need background IP. And I must say, not all universities and all TTOs have got access to this kind of information and are able to analyze information. So it's really a very specific service, and some providers are able to help us in that. Cost money, of course, money and time, but this is definitely something that could be very useful for probably all TTOs in Europe. To me, PathLib people could be as seen as external experts. And as I said before, sometimes external experts have got a different capacity of convincing people within university. So it could be very useful to explain with PathLib people what IP is and what IP is not, and what IP tools, namely patents, can do for you and cannot do. So we cannot expect everything, every issue to be solved by IP, but it's important to understand what IP can do for you and how you can use it. I will maybe just take one example. I hear very often, well, either from our researchers, either from partners, that a patent can give access to a market, which is not really true. I mean, at least it's not as simple as that. And so the confusion between IP, IP rights, and access to the market is, I think, something we could and we should correct together. So patents can be a real good asset to get to the market and also to convince investors, but this is not enough, obviously. And I'm not going to explain to you the difference between having a patent and having a freedom to operate, but this is also a very common mistake. So these are the sort of explanations that should be brought to the different stakeholders. Now, there are many ways to explain these sort of issues, and that goes through raising awareness, of course, and providing trainings, including training, I mean, very basic trainings. It's an endless task, okay, to bring this knowledge about IP and the culture about IP to newcomers or even to existing companies who never really took the time to know better about that. And I'm convinced that many TTOs would appreciate professional support from PathLib. So offering expertise is obvious. I can see that some guidance could be brought. I don't know, maybe to some negotiations, maybe to some policies designing. But in that case, we should be aware that it might be felt like a bit of competition. Well, competition with the TTO themselves, because this is their job. So we really should build partnership there again with PathLib. It could be also seen as a competition with professional service providers. So this is probably an issue for the PathLibs. We can talk about this a bit later. Now, I would like to discuss about some specific issues in the field of IP within universities. First, again, I'm aware I'm talking in the frame of the European Patent Office, but we sometimes face the question of the patent obsession. So I would like to say here that getting a patent is not always the best solution. It's never the only solution, but it's sometimes not the best solution. So we definitely have to consider all the other intangible non-IP assets, as I mentioned before. And sometimes you know that in some domains it's better to keep secret some aspects of the inventions, and so we are dealing with the know-how or recette, so secret recipes for, I don't know, perfumes, food industry, etc., some examples. So it's not always about patent, and so we can use in a very different ways patents within the academic. So we are using the patent usually to signal ourselves. So it's sort of communication to getting the image, giving the image of being innovative, inventive, etc. Patents have been used as indicators, sometimes as key performance indicators. And there is a certain danger there, because if you talk about filed patents or issued patents, if you only consider that, this is not enough. I mean, you've got to connect this with the licensing activities then and also spin-off creation. So a patent is not enough to provide impact, especially impact on commercial activities. But of course, when we go on the side of our industrial partners, of course, a patent can be an asset for investors in the case of spin-off. And obviously, it can be a very powerful tool for market protection for our commercial and industrial partners. So this is fine as long as we have the common understanding about what we can find in IP agreements. So, and we've been experiencing these sort of problems with the partners when negotiating licenses, because there's sometimes a bad understanding of what exclusivity means, what's the best solution between licensing or assignment, IP assignment, how do we get to a price for this IP agreements, and what specific financial conditions we could find, for instance, in the case of creating a spin-off. And so this common understanding is extremely important. For whom? Well, for our researchers and for the investors we're going to put money in our spin-off, but also understanding for the founders of the spin-off, who might be some of university staff. And also we got a complete ecosystem with an innovation agency, funding bodies, incubator, innovation agency, you name that. So many mentoring and coaching, and that should be really understood by these people as well, because they are supposed to provide advice for spin-off creators. And sometimes it can be a source of misunderstanding and very long negotiation. So again, we got to explain to these people what the good rules are and what are the reasonable agreements we can find. And this is true, obviously, with our partners, the private companies, of course. I would say that it's important also that the high-level staff are also involved and educated to these issues about IP. And I'm talking about political people, so political staff, leaders, public research organization leaders as well, and policymakers. And this is also an endless task. And we have to realize that sometimes people talk about what they don't really know about. Okay, let's put it this way. All right, so I would like to spend some time about what support we can bring to creators of spin-off. So this will be, of course, centered around background IP and IP rights. I would point out that the rules of the university and the interest for universities should be very clear. So we are talking about IP and spin-off policies. And in that matter, I think that also the PATLIB could probably help when just talking and exchanging views with the different TTOs and the different universities bodies. Well, but the support from university to spin-off are very wide, actually, if you think about it. We are talking about getting in long-term relationship and bringing a good image and reputation. We are talking about launching new R&D projects, which will lead to new ideas and new IP. And then, of course, access to resources, access to skilled students that the spin-off can recruit, and also strategic advice, especially about science. I'm not talking about university bringing knowledge about business plan or access to the market. This is not our role. This is not our job. And I would say that the TTO role within the global ecosystem could really and definitely include PATLIB, as I said before, as an external advisor specialist about IP and patents and patent information. Okay, so the complementarity with PATLIB is still to build, but I think it's quite obvious, and we will have a presentation about that in the coming minutes. Let's close the presentation here, and I hand over to Edil so she can talk a little bit more about TTOs and PATLIB and the relationship between the two of them. Thanks a lot for your attention.